Okay. So, the UV workshop. The previous video we went over the very, very, very basic idea of how to unfurl these. That is something we'll go over later in more detail, but I want simply want you to understand the relationship between this piece of geometry and this image here, because this is just a map. And it's a map that we have brought into Photoshop. And if you look in the UV Workshop folder, under source images, you can see there's one for the frame, which is the homework later, and then there's one for the plane. And it's already got my smiley face on it, but you can put other things on it if you'd like. So it's already set up. You want to make sure you're drawing on the drawing layer and not this top layer with the UVs. That is, again, only there as a guide. But for funsies, I drew a smiley face. And then, so we can also see something else that this does in Maya, I'm going to paint along the edges. Just a nope. Just so we can kind of see how that works. It's not, I'm not actually making anything naturalistic. These are just examples of how things work. I'm also, just so we understand something, going to make a couple of squiggles over here because there's something important to understand here. If it's outside the lines, you're not going to see it, which is great. It means we don't have to worry about staying inside the line. So you're never going to see this blue anywhere. And frankly, what it also means is that I was a little bit too careful over here. I didn't fill in along the, good grief. I didn't fill in along these edges. So there would have been like white space on there because I didn't paint all the way out. So I can go outside the edges. It's not going to ruin my texture. What would ruin it is if I didn't paint where I was supposed to. So let me see. The other thing to think about is these seams. These little insets right here are seams. If we go into Maya right here, if I go into my UV editor and go to UVs, JK, go to edges. See how I hover over the edge? It looks the same as it does here, right? When you're in edge mode, this is what happens when you it tells you and you can highlight whole things, etc. And yet look what happens when I hover over here. I'm hovering over one edge, but two of them highlight because there's not two. It's just one. It's this edge. There we go. Why is it not red? There it is. It's red over here. It's red underneath here. That's the same edge that has been split on the UV map because remember, when you take a three-dimensional object and you splice it off to be a two-dimensional map, there will either be distortions or seams. Now, because this is so very geometric, I mean, I could technically bring this down here and bring this down here. Well, now this whole thing is distorted. Or maybe I bring them up here. You know, there's no way to avoid having some form of distortion. This has turned blue because it's telling me this space is too big. Now there won't be a seam anymore, but how am I going to paint on there? So, because of the geometric shape of this and how even it is and how obvious this seam is, I have elected to go with seams instead of distortion. That answer will change depending on what you're making. And there's ways to hide these things depending on what you're doing. Obviously, the bottom of this, like depending on the camera angle, you won't see it. And if I do have to worry about seeing the top of this, well, I can paint, I can either do what I did here, which is, oh, it's going to be exactly the same, so you won't see the seam. Or I can actually, nope, that's not how you zoom in on Photoshop. I can purposefully play up, no, I want a burn tool, how it looks. There we go. As an edge. So what I can do is if I turn my exposure way up and bring this up a bit, I can, I'm thinking this is a shadow. There we go. I can play up the fact that this is a seam. So I can make it so that, yeah, we know it's a seam. It's darker right there. We can kind of play with that idea to make it a more obvious thing. All right, so let's say we're done, this is my texture, okay? One thing we need to do besides saving it is turn off the UV layer. So whenever you're texturing something, make sure you turn off the UV layer, because remember, these are just guide marks. We don't want a giant grid of, I mean, maybe you do, but I don't want a giant grid on top of that model, right? I need to get rid of this. So I turn that off, and if you turn that off, it'll stay in the file. You know, you hit Control S to save, so it'll still be there if you need to go back and change things, but it won't be seen. So Maya's smart enough not to look at hidden layers, which is great for us. All right, so I come back in here in object mode, and I go back into Maya Classic so I can see this and not have to deal with things. And so let me see if I have a texture. Yes, I do. So the file already that I provided with you already has a new material. Remember, you can right click assign new material, like to make a new one, or you can use the, you can use the hypergraph, which is under Window Rendering Editor. I'm sorry, Hypershade, not the hypergraph. You can use our friend, the Hypershade, to create something. And we are gonna go back to the Hypershade in a little bit. But the way applying texture maps works is by attaching that file, usually a PSD, sometimes a JPEG, to these inputs, to these properties. So these properties that we've been dealing with, normally we're just like, oh, it's going to be orange, and then we make it orange, and then it's orange. Well, that's not orange. That's brown. But you get my meaning. We would just change the color here, or we would turn up the transparency, or whatever. We would just, it would be a universal thing. But many of you asked me, well, how do we change the color, you know, different parts to different colors? And the answer is a texture map, which is why we did the UV mapping, because it needs to know how to take that information, this visual information, and plant it on this. So how do we technically tell it to do that? Well, you go to the property that you want to attach a file to, which in this case is color. And at the end of it, you'll see a little checkbox. That checkerboard is meant to look like the checkerboard that we were using to see if there was distortions. And when I click on the checkerboard, it brings up a create render node. So we have to create a new render node to process this information. And I know it's tempting to do the ocean one or the ramp one or this noise or this really terrible granite and leather. Please don't do that later. But you can click the one that says file. And when we do that, it creates a new node, and this all changes up in our attribute editor. And there's a whole bunch of information here, but you're looking for the part that says image name and then folder. We click on the folder, and if your project is working properly, it will bring you directly to the source images for your project folder. If it's not, you really need to set your project, because we don't want it looking for all of this in the Stephanie NVCC. We want it to be looking for it in ... source images because what that means is that it should be always looking for it in the same directory as the scene file, except source images rather than scenes. So if it doesn't bring you to this, make sure you set your project. But we're looking for this PSD because this is the plane we're dealing with, and I hit open. And if nothing happens, go to shading, hardware texturing. Because if you don't turn that on, you're not going to see this. But otherwise, you should see this. And if you're looking straight at it, it should look proportionally exactly the same as what was drawn here. And my edges are purple because remember, my texture map said that these flaps right here, these are the edges. So where I painted this purple is those sides. That's how I knew how to get these edges purple, is because that texture map told me. Now I did a poor job. You can see there, it doesn't quite go there. On the top and bottom, the sides I did a better job. And there you can see the seam that I was playing up on purpose. Now, it doesn't quite work because I didn't make one side as dark as the other. Right? So I would have to go back in and do a better job of burning this side to be just as dark. In the meantime, this seam looks perfectly fine, except that, you know, it's just the lighting. So, and this is the part we have to worry about. where I didn't paint it correctly. So these are the kinds of things you would go back in and you would fix it, and you have to make sure they kind of match, at least in a way that wouldn't be noticeable from wherever your camera is. All right, so we've applied a texture map to the color, and it looks exactly like we'd expect it to. But we can apply a texture map to almost anything. So if I wanna get back to where I was, I have to select this item, and the attribute editor will show this again. And same thing as we did for color, I can do for transparency. And click that button, click the file node, it loads this up, I click that folder, and I select the file. And I have to select it for each property that I want to attach it to. Now, it takes the transparency information from the same image. Basically, it looks at the alpha channel of this image. So here, it's an alpha of, let me get this right. It's basically 0 to 1, and this is 0, and this is 1. Anywhere that there is this drawing is 1, meaning opaque, fully opaque. Anywhere where you see the checkboxes, 0, meaning fully transparent. Now, because we are dealing with Photoshop brushes, there are tiny little areas that might be very, very, very semi-transparent. I'm not sure how much that translates in here. We can see if there's a little bit of, there it is, just a little bit of fuzziness. A little bit hard to tell because we're not, there's nothing else in here. So there's no lighting in here. There's nothing passing through here except more gray. So it's hard to tell how that would manifest if you had actual stuff in here. But that's the general idea. You can have a transparency map. And if you think about things that have that are very, very thin, you can make them semi-transparent in the middle. You can, like leaves and things are transparent along the edges or semi-transparent. So it's not usually smiley face in the middle of a pane of glass, although it could be. It's more often gradients of transparency and things like that. And also, if you were to have this, this would be problematic because, as you can see, there's no faces here. What we're looking at isn't the inside of the frame, it's the nothingness of the frame. It's how these planes that you're looking at are having an existential crisis. So we would need to have some sort of geometry in there to texture if this is how we were going to do things. Now I left the Hypershade open because I wanted to show you just how much it takes to have our silly little smiley face on a window pane. Can I get rid of, nope. There we go. I want to zoom in so we can see this. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 nodes to pull this off. This is one of the shader nodes. There is also this other one. So technically, whenever we have any type of shader on here, there's, I got rid of it, all right. There's basically two nodes, there we go. So this is the shading group that it's part of. And then this is all of the information we're usually dealing with. If you really get into texturing and stuff, you will be dealing with this one. So you already need two, right? Then what's technically happening is for the, which one is which? This is for the color. And I can tell that because it's, you can see this line where it's like an input output to the color. So these are inputs, these are outputs. So what is happening is that this node called file one, there's information in it. There's, in particular, this information. Right? It is a PSD. It has file information. It's going into this place 2D texture node. So this visual information is going into here. And it's saying, all right, we need to look at this. And this is, you can see out UVs. So it's saying how to take this visual information into the UV coordinates. And then it's outputting that color based on these UV coordinates to this color here on this texture map. Get it? And it's doing the same thing for this. In order to get the transparency map, it has to take that same file, process it basically through a 2D texture node, which then takes the UV coordinates and puts them over here, which then tells this how to output this information to here. And you can see out color over here is going into color. There's something else going into transparency. It's, I think it's just the overall file information. I could attach the R, the G, or the B to the transparency. I would get very different results. Or the out alpha, but instead I think it's taking the whole, it's taking something else from here. But it takes 6 nodes to get a smiley face on a pane of glass. I told the people in class, you know, keep that in mind next time you want to drag a TV show for not having great textures, because that has probably dozens of characters and hundreds of, like, props and buildings and things, and they all require that same amount of stuff, if not more. So it's just things I like to keep in mind when I'm looking at the, you know, other stuff that other people have made. Now, if we want to get rid of something that is like a linked texture, like if you don't want the transparency on here anymore, I can go into here and I'm going to select both the nodes that go to the transparency, both this file node and the 2D placement texture node, and I just hit delete. And now the transparency is free again. I can make the whole thing generally transparent if I want to, or not. The third one I wanted to show you is, you can attach this to anything, but it's, I want to show the most obvious ones and the most sort of useful ones. They would be color transparency and bump mapping. We won't really get to bump mapping in this class too much, but it's a way of adding detail in without having any modeling added. There's no resolution added, which means lighting and rendering is cheaper, so you don't have to work quite so hard to get things rendered. But you click that same checkbox and you click the file button, it opens up this. It's a little different, and it's already half set up to like take a file in, so you click where it already has that and then it brings you to the file place. And then I click that and I hit open. And I don't know how well you will be able to see this on the YouTube. Hopefully you can. But you can see how there's a bit of an edge there. So that bump map is saying, there we go. It's looking at this and saying, all right, take this image, and it's looking at the light dark value of the image. So anywhere it's white, it's raised up all the way, and anywhere it's dark, it's pushed in all the way. So technically speaking, the purple area is relatively dark. So we can see kind of an edge there, like a lit edge there, because it's deeper than the white part. You can even see it a little bit on that side. But it's adding depth. Now, it obviously is very, very silly with the smiley face, but oh, here we go. Where I added that burning, you can see how it's like affecting the lighting and it's making it very dark in there. That's because the lighting thinks there's an edge there. It's adding details for the light to catch without adding any modeling. There's no edge loops I had to add in there to add this depth. And we use this for like really fine texture detail. Texture meaning like visceral texture of a physical object. So if something isn't perfectly flat plastic, I'm looking around my desk right here, and even the desk itself, it's not real wood, it's like IKEA wood, but it, you know, there is a texture to it, and you would use a bump map for that. Whereas like my glass of water is glass, it doesn't really have a bump on it because it's so flat. Shiny plastic would not have a bump map on it. Matte plastic would. If you look at your keyboard, I'm looking at mine, you could have a bump map on it. Let's see, my planner right here, definitely any type of book or something, there is a texture to it. So if you look at something and think, oh, this would not be smooth when I hold on to it, that would be something you might put a bump map on, even a subtle one, and that can add a lot to your textures. Again, we might not get into that too much this semester, depending on time, because it is a lot, but it's a great way to add depth to something. And it's a linked file, and it's a lot more nodes than before. So if I want this one back up, I think I can change Whoa. Yeah, I can reverse it if I want. So you can see if I change this way, it goes in the other direction. But it takes the same file node, the same 2D texture node, place 2D texture node with the UV coordinates, but also we need to process it through a new node that's like, this is a bump map. It's a little bit different. So this doesn't have the bump mapping in it. This has to tell it what to do. And then if you look real close, it's not going into something called the bump, it's going into something called the normal camera. So the normal camera has to, what we're doing is we're changing surface normals. Surface normals are the direction of the surface. And if I look, where is it? Display, polygons, face normals. That's the general overall face normal. But you can give it more details than that, and that's what this is referring to. So this, it's taking that visual information, turning it into a bump value, and then expressing that as surface direction. That's at a finer detail than you have in your model. So that's what it takes, and that's why we're very slowly introducing the idea of shaders and textures, because it's very complicated and it's easy to break. But it's also very, very powerful if you can start to get your head wrapped around these nodes that you can't see and how they link to each other.